Okay. My name is Amit Apte. I'm from ICTS, the International Center for Theoretical Sciences. And some of you already have known about CAPI. You may have come for previous talks. But anyway, I'll say a couple of words about this series, which is called CAPI with Curiosity, which is a series of lectures, interactions of scientists with the general public, including working professionals, school children, college kids, and all across the society, in order to try to talk about what we do, what we love to do, what we really like to do, and we would like to excite you to be also part of this endeavor of inquiry. That is basically what science is about. And this is a series that's right now organized in collaboration with Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium, where we are, and Vishweshwaraya Industrial and Technology Museum, VITM, where the last lecture happened. Some of you may have been there. What we'd really like to do is to incite curiosity in thinking about science, scientific questions, and basically all of science originates with curiosity. And this is one of my all-time favorite quotes about science in general, that, you know, curiosity is really a very, very important part of science. If you are curious enough, then, of course, then you have to be disciplined and then get technically adept and so on and so forth, but it all starts with curiosity, and it ends with coffee. So we will start with a brief words about the planetarium by the director, Shailaja. So, please.
Good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to see you all here back for this second lecture that is happening here. And as you know, our institute here is basically interested in motivating students towards a career in science, or I should say appreciating science or doing science. So you associate the word planetarium usually with the stars, but we also want you to see the things that are around you on the ground. So this is a very interesting topic, and it's great that Sanjay Sane has agreed to come and give a talk here. And those many of you have heard him before, and you will realize the meaning of my statements now. I will not spend much time. We will look forward to hearing from the lecture from him. Now, I think about the speaker.
So, as is customary, I would request Rajesh Gopakumar, who is the director of ICTS, he's there, I was trying to look for you, to say a few words about ICTS. Some of you may have heard some of this before, but it's.
Thanks. That's why I didn't want to inflict a sort of a presentation on ICTS on you yet again. But I just, for those who are new and who haven't been to this event before, Amit has already said about CAPI with Curiosity. That's one of the main outreach activities that ICTS is involved in, and we thank the planetarium as well as VITM for partnering with us in this, and we look forward to many, many exciting lectures. Please stay tuned for the lectures. You can visit our Facebook page, our web page. You can ask to be on a mailing list. If you go to our webpage and sign up, they will send you the regular notices for this, for these events. In particular, next month, we will have a talk by David Gross, Nobel laureate in physics, on sort of the frontiers of physics. Stay tuned for the announcement. For that, it will be on January 14th. In the evening, probably. About ICTS, in general, ICTS is a new institute for research in basic sciences, which span all the way from biology to theoretical physics, through mathematics, computer science, and other such disciplines. So we have a research faculty and students. We also have one of our other important aims is to organize programs in which a number of visitors, scientists in different areas of the sciences come and collaborate and spend time in India. These are experts from around the world. That's why we are called the International Center. So we please look at our webpage for some of the programs and other distinguished lectures, public lectures, and so on by experts in various subjects. So I would urge you all to take a look at our webpage and keep abreast of these events. So we are located in Hesarghatta. Maybe you saw the slide which showed where we are located. But if you want to come for any of our events, look up our Facebook page, and typically we arrange transportation. There are shuttles from IASC and so on to bring you to ICTS in case you want to come for any of our events. So that's about it for ICTS. And I think I'll ask Vishal to come and introduce the speaker. We are very happy that we could finally get Sanjay to talk. This was supposed to be the inaugural talk of the Copy with Curiosity in September, but because of the buns and the related events in September, this had to be postponed. But we are happy that it's finally happening. Thanks, Sanjay.
Hi. My name is Vishal Vasan. I'm also from ICTS. It's a great pleasure to have Professor Sanjay Sane speak to us today. Professor Sanjay Sane is from the National Center for Biological Sciences, part of the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research at our very own Bangalore. He did his bachelor's degree in physics, chemistry, and mathematics from St. Stephen's in Delhi, and then went on to work in astrodynamics and nonlinear dynamics, astrophysics and nonlinear dynamics at University of Pune. And I'm told he's had a very long time interest in insects. And so finally, he got to work on insects when he went to University of California in Berkeley, working on the lab of Wilkinson on insect flight. And so he continued this work as a postdoc, furthering his studies about insect flight. And I think now he works on a broad range of things from, you know, collective, how do groups of termites work together, how do insects fly, what are the processes that, you know, decide how an insect will fly, the sensors and guides it uses to direct its flight. And so today he'll talk even more about insect architecture. So thank you very much. And before I hand it over to Sanjay, just a house rule. Can you all please remember to turn off your cell phones, or at least put it on airplane mode so that we don't have any interruptions? So thank you, Sanjay.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for inviting me for this. This is a project that has been sort of a hobby project that is slowly starting to take center stage in my lab. But at the heart of this project is really what this talk series is all about, it's curiosity. And what I want to be able to do through the process of this talk is to emphasize that science is in your backyard, that you don't need fancy instruments to be able to do science, that there is a lot happening all around you, and you know, you should really look around and open your eyes, open your mind, and that's where it is. So let me start with these two slides, or these two pictures. The first is Caen de Bananes, widely considered to be the oldest building. As far as we know, it's clearly already fairly evolved by the time we see it. And you know, it's quite a remarkable structure as of itself. This is the lower Manhattan, almost as of today. And as you can see, our architectural prowess is certainly, I mean, this is a testimony to human ingenuity and creativity. But architecture is not just the purview of humans. In fact, architecture has been around forever. And let me start with mammals. So this is a beaver. This is somewhere near Alberta, Canada, and this particular dam has been built by this beaver. Now, what the beaver does is, it, in addition to this dam, it also builds a cabin in which it lives, and it needs, this cabin is right in the middle of the water here. You don't see it, it builds the dam first. But the cabin is built by the beaver so it can live in it and reproduce and so on. But it needs to make sure that the water levels stay at a certain certain optimal length, depth. And to do this, it builds a dam. Okay, this is a remarkable structure, as you can see. And it's built by this little creature. Here is a prairie dog nest, as you can see from the inside. And again, in this nest, it's again a rodent, just like the beaver is, a slightly smaller one, but it's social. So unlike the beaver, it tends to be solitary. The prairie dogs live in a community, and that community is all housed within these nests right here. And as you can see, these nests are remarkable in that they have an inner, almost a maze of tunnels in which there are chambers and passages and so on, which allow these prairie dogs to house themselves, breed, store food, and all of this. And there are very nice little solutions in all of this. For instance, you might ask, how does a tunnel like this get ventilated? Well, you can see that there are these little bumps up here, and some of the holes are not so high. And so when you have this difference in height and when there's a wind passing over it, there's an automatic ventilation of these burrows. And this is a principle that we see being used again and again by animals when they need to ventilate their burrows. So these are mammals, okay, rodents. How about birds? Many of you have seen this. This is the baya, the weaver bird, which is an extraordinary bird for being able to build this wonderful structure. This is where the pair then lays eggs, and the youngsters are fledged. And this structure is a masterpiece. It can withstand very heavy winds, storms, rain, all sorts of things. And in case you thought that this happened only once and was a freak event in evolution, that's not true. Completely independently, in the New World, this is the Oropendula, okay, which builds a very similar nest. It's not even related to this bird. It is closer to orioles, I'm told. But it also builds a very similar nest, and it is also extraordinarily, it can withstand very heavy winds and so on. So these sorts of structures are being built by not just mammals and birds, but also by marine animals, invertebrates. This thing is a lugworm. And here again, you see the same principle as you saw in the case of prairie dogs. You have a little bump. This is made by the fecal matter of this worm called Arenicola. And this is submerged underwater. And what this lugworm does is it filter feeds. Okay, so you can see how that looks, that wormhole looks. There's a fecal matter here. There's a hole here. There's a difference in height. And when water flows over it, there is some that is diverted through the tunnel just because of the pressure difference between here and here. Okay? And this, of course, is the coral reef, some of the most important sites of biodiversity are coral reefs. And these are built by little creatures that are relatives of jellyfishes. So these are extraordinary examples of architecture. They serve just about every function that the animal requires for this structure to serve. And yet, they're built by animals that you know, many people don't even know that these animals have brains. They have not just complex nervous systems, but they're able to actually make remarkable decisions based on external conditions. Do we have to go to Canada or, you know, to reefs or to mudflats to see these things? No, we can see them all around us. In fact, they are in your backyard, and I'm just going to give you four examples of things that you find right here in Bangalore in your backyard. This is the beehive of the rock bee, the Apis dorsata. This is a nasty bee, you shouldn't get too close to it. But this is its hive. And this is where you have a queen, and the queen is surrounded by workers, scouts, soldiers, all sorts of things that make up this hive. And you can see them all huddled together here, and they are able to do remarkable things in this hive. So this hive is where they collect honey, where they brood their young, where they are able to, in fact, nurture their young all the way to adulthood so that they may serve. These are like cities. Now, the interesting thing about this is a large society. And in biology, they've been often called superorganisms because the hive itself operates as a animal would operate, as a whole animal would operate. And I'll come to that later. Here is another example, again from your backyard. This is the Ecophylla, the weaver ant, another very, very interesting animal. What it does, it uses the larvae as something like, it's almost like a toothpaste, right? So what it does is it keeps squeezing the larvae, stimulating it. The larvae secretes a thread, and it uses this thread to weave together these leaves to form a nest, okay? And this is done collectively. As you can see, there's a lot of ants that need to work together, cooperate, to be able to get this thing to work. Now, this is not a mean task, not a mean task for humans, certainly not a mean task for insects, but they're able to make it look really simple. More examples. Here's a paper wasp. You see this large, really interesting nest that is built by paper wasps. What they do is they digest wood and they turn it into paper. And they use this to build this very light structure, which nonetheless is very complex from the inside. And here's one of those at an early stage when they're building these little chambers. And you can see that there are all these wasps that work together in order to make these structures. Then there is the carpenter bee, okay? The carpenter bee is a bee that you'll see. It's a large black bee that you'll see around here. Often it is flying around and guarding territories and so on. And what it does is it makes these neat little holes in dry wood. So if there are dead trees, for instance, you might see some dead trees with little round holes. They're precisely round, like this, which they make with a hard proboscis, a mouth part. And if you cut open that thing, you will see what they are really making. This is a nice set of chambers in which they put their young, and then they periodically go out, catch something, bring it back, feed it, okay? These are insects. Insects have brains that are substantially smaller than ours. People often wonder if these are thinking, feeling creatures, or are they robots? But I want to show you a video which should argue, I think, that these are extraordinary animals. And not only are they extraordinary in the sense that they are able to build this, but that building is a sensorial process. It's a process which requires them to think and act and respond to what is happening. And so I'm going to show you another animal that you find in your backyard. It's called a potter wasp, okay? And this I pulled off of YouTube. So let's watch this at work. don't need the audio for this. But you can see what it's doing with its antenna. The antenna is being constantly used to feel. It has at the base of it really sensitive mechanosensors, which are used to sense the environment. They also sense odor. There are eyes. There are mouth parts. There are legs. And it's using all of these to create this remarkable nest, which looks like a pot. Now comes my, just after this comes my favorite part. Okay, here we go. Look at that. This is something you will see around if you look. These are very much around in Bangalore. The material is mud. It's mud mixed with saliva. And now it will lay eggs inside. And it flies away. And it flies away partly to go and catch some poor creature that it can then sting, paralyze, bring back, drop it inside, and then the young caterpillars are going to eat up that that poor creature while it is still in the paralytic state, because it can't decay. If it decays, then it's not good food. So there's an enormous amount of things that happen after this, but I'm just focusing on the architecture part. And of course, you've all seen this, the spider, this remarkable nest that is built by the spider. And it is, again, a structure that is built with a certain program in mind. I don't want to make it sound too much like a computer, but there is an algorithm running in the brain, and that algorithm is being used again and again by spiders to do this. How do we know this? How do we know that this is not just something happening by itself? Well, scientists have carried out some interesting experiments. For instance, here's a normal spider, but here's a spider that's given some dope. Okay? Here's some that is with benzedrine, not very different from this. Here's some which has been on copy. And this is chloralhydrate. So you can actually manipulate. These are experiments. I mean, they're amusing, but they're experiments. And these experiments tell you that there is, underlying all of this, a algorithm, and that algorithm you can play around with by pharmaceutically, just as you would in the case of a human being. So this is the backdrop. There is architecture everywhere. There's so much to learn from it. There are so many principles. I mean, I haven't even started talking about the material that is used to build this. This is one of the strongest materials that we know. Stronger than steel. It is remarkably elastic because it has to absorb the impact of a flying insect that it is going to capture. The spider has wonderful techniques of figuring out whether something was caught there or not. It has a very, very keen eyesight, but it also has vibration sensors. So it sits on the web and it's looking for vibrations. And if the vibrations don't suggest an insect, they don't even bother. But if it suggests a struggling insect, in other words, if the frequency of the movements are of a certain kind, then the spider is interested. It'll go, it'll capture, sting, you know, and eventually bundle it up and eat it at leisure. Okay, so these are the sorts of things that are going on. And we got very interested in this. I mean, I've always been gossiping about it for many, many years. But an opportunity arose some years ago to actually take this somewhere. And this largely arose right in our backyard. We had these enormous mounds of termites, and that's what we decided to work with. So here's a termite mound. Here's a student who's working on it. He's right there in the back if you want to meet him. He's done much of this work. He's, I would say, about 6 foot tall. So the termite mound is currently beating him. I don't think he's a growing boy anymore. This is the termite mound. What a remarkable structure. And you've all seen it. It's all around us. It is made of mud, but it is not just mud. It is actually mud mixed with other things that are within the gut of the termite. And what this contains is a large colony of termites. Okay, and I'm going to tell you about this colony. And there is as much of it overground, underground as overground. Okay, so it's actually excavating mud from top, piling it, and then, if you notice carefully, it has these folds, and these folds are important. And we don't know why they are important, but we know they are important. Okay, and part of what we are trying to find out is why are they important. The colony contains of queens, soldiers, major workers, minor workers, and they are all without wings, except one caste of termites called the alate termites. Alate, ailer means with wings, so alates are termites with wings. And I'm sure all of you have noticed that when it rains, you see a large number of these termites all around the lights, and they're flying. And these are termites. They fly just for that much. They mate, they fall down, they lose their wings, and then they form a colony. Okay? There's something even more interesting about this. Inside this mound, there is a fungus that grows only in the mound, and that the termites actually harvest. And the fungus helps the termite digest wood, and the termite helps the fungus actually by giving it food. So it brings, cuts wood from elsewhere, brings it to the fungus digests it for the termite, and then that allows this mound to survive. Now the interesting thing is that if you were to look at the net metabolism of this mound, the carbon dioxide coming out of it and so on, the fungus accounts for more of it than the termites. So if you are somebody who likes to study fungus, you might turn the question around and ask if the fungus, if this mound belongs to the fungus, and the termites are just little helpers that help the fungus. I mean, that's just a matter of perspective. Inside this mound, underneath it, is a complex maze of tunnels, bridges, and all sorts of very, very interesting things. Let me show you a video of what this activity looks like and how remarkable it is and just how much in numbers. So this is our institute at night. Everyone's sleeping. You go down into the ground, and there it is. This is all the activity. Teeming with termites. Going about their business, right? Let me give you just a brief lesson in what termites are, really. They are actually very close relatives of cockroaches. In fact, they are cockroaches. They are this branch of cockroaches that have become social. And so this is the mound. And when it rains and when the conditions are right, the mound emits these guys, the alates, which I just told you about, the guys with wings. They will fly about. They will mate. When they mate, they drop down. Both the pair drops down, by the way. And they will lose their wings. And then the female begins to grow. And she grows until she becomes as big as my thumb. Okay? She starts with a few millimeters in size, but then she's as big as my thumb. And much of that size is just the abdomen. Okay? This is a giant ovary. It's an egg-laying machine. Okay? This is the body. It's got little legs, it's got eyes and so on. It's alive, and it will stay alive for decades. And it will continue to produce eggs for all this time, and these eggs will produce workers, soldiers, workers, major, minor workers, and all of these together then build this mound. Okay, this is how the cycle works. Inside this mound is extremely complex. Now, how do you go about studying things like this? How do you know how complex it is? One way to do this is, as my collaborator and friend Rupert Soar, he's an architect from UK, has been employing this method in which he essentially makes a hole in this mound and pumps in plaster of Paris, lots of it. And at the end of it, what you do is let it harden, and then you wash off all the mud from the top, and what you get is a negative image of the, a negative 3D image of the mound. And then you can scan this, and you can then turn it into, it gives you some idea of what the internal structure of the mound would be like. And that's sort of the reconstruction of that mound. It's an extraordinarily complex process, but I just thought I'll show you some of the intricacies of how this works. So I'm going to, better than me, I think, David Attenborough, who was partly responsible for why I'm even doing biology, because he has such inspirational videos. He, in one of his documentaries, Life in the Undergrowth, talks about termite mounds in South Africa. So I'll just play that video for you.
Here in South Africa, it can also get very hot, but there's no danger of flooding. So termites can take refuge from the heat below ground, where it's cool and relatively stable. But 2 million insects living below ground create a different kind of problem. The air around them gets stale. So termites need to have a way of linking the underground air with the fresh air above, a ventilation system. And they do that with this. And to see how it works, you've got to look inside. Using the latest scanning techniques, we can create a picture of the mound's interior. An intricate network of passages lead to a central chimney. Hot, stale air from the insect population below rises up through the chimney. But the top of the mound is sealed. So how does this stale air escape? The mound may look as though it has strong defensive walls like a fortress, but in fact these walls are porous and their primary purpose is to harness the wind. Fresh air blowing against the side of the mound is forced through the tiny holes in these walls. From there, it travels through the smaller tunnels until it reaches the central chimney. Here, the cooler fresh air mixes with the hot stale air rising from the insect community below. Meanwhile, some air is blown around the side of the mound. This creates a suction that pulls the stale air out of the chimney and out through the outer walls. So an internal air current is created and the whole mound ventilated. The mound's inhabitants spend most of their time close to or below ground level. Beneath their living quarters, there are garden chambers where the termites cultivate a fungus that rots the wood and vegetation they collect and make it digestible. Farther down still, the queen lies in her own chamber. Her huge body is a gigantic egg-producing factory. She's so swollen that she can't look after herself. The workers must constantly clean her and feed her with food from their own crops. Her partner, with whom she founded the colony maybe 20 years ago, is still with her and mates with her throughout her life. She lays eggs at an extraordinary rate, as many as 30,000 a day. As she produces them, so workers remove them from the royal chamber and take them to nurseries. There they'll be fed on compost from the fungus gardens until they turn into adults. The superorganism that lives in this great castle crops the surrounding vegetation just about as severely as an antelope. The density of individual termites around here is extraordinary, over 100,000 per square meter. And just as there are lions and leopard that hunt antelope, so in the undergrowth, there are insect hunters which prey on the tiny herbivores, the ants, the termites' ancient enemy.
Matabele ants, specialist termite hunters.
A scout has laid down a clear chemical trail, and this battalion of workers have picked it up and are following it. There may be only a few hundred of them, but they're going to severely test the defenses of a termite colony.
The mound has formidable guards, soldier termites. The ants have a special technique for dealing with these soldiers. They grab the termite's jaw and then sting it in the only vulnerable place on its head, in its mouth. The ants' front line breaks into the colony. Reinforcements for the termite soldiers arrive quickly. Already there are casualties on both sides. But the invaders overwhelm the defenders. It's not to the ants' advantage to kill an entire termite colony, any more than it would be sensible for farmers to exterminate their cattle. Better to let most survive so that they can be regularly raided. So, although there are millions of termites in the colony, the Matabele ants rarely go deep into the nest to press home their victory. The raid lasts less than 15 minutes. Nonetheless, the spoils are impressive. Termite bodies are now being piled in dumps outside the nest.
Right, so I chose this film partly for two reasons. One, because there is a hypothesis in here about what the function of the mound is. What is this large structure for? And if you notice, at very early in the film, David Attenborough talks about how this region is so arid that there's no chance of it ever getting flooded. And so, you know, they build these structures and so on. Now, we have these mounds here in India, where there's a substantial monsoon season. And so there's the question that we continue to ask is, you know, how are the South African mounds compared to the Indian mounds? And the only hypothesis we have come from the South African mounds, okay, which involve exchange this hypothesis that it has a porous surface in which air circulates and so on. And then there are these open chimney mounds in which there's a large opening, and then actually there is an outlet and an inlet. The problem, of course, is that we don't see any of this in the Indian mounds. The Indian mounds are closed. They're almost like upside-down pots. And if there is porosity in there, then that is extremely hard to observe in any practical way. And my lab has been more and more interested in looking at the individual level. How do termites know what to do? How do they know where to excavate, where to lay down mud? How is the traffic inside this mound controlled? And questions like that. And so we got really interested in this question. I should add one more point to this, which is that your average termite, the soldier and the worker, not the allates, the allates have eyes, but the worker and the soldier termites, the ones that actually build the mound, don't have any eyes. This is the head of the termite, that's the antenna, that's the mandibles, and as you can see, there are no eyes. And so how are they able to do this in absence of any visual input? So this was something that we got very interested in. So let's look at some of these termites and what they do. Okay, so here's a video of them as they are building. And they're continually modifying and remodeling the mound. And it's an enormous task of maintenance. And mounds that die very quickly fall to pieces. And you can see them, sort of chunks of them coming off. And you immediately see it, and you know whether this is a live mound or a dead mound. And what they're doing is they're collecting little pellets of sand. They're taking the sand in, mixing it with the saliva. And the saliva is some mixture of digested plant material called lignin, which makes it hard. And then they take it out, and then they push it against the surface. Okay, I'll just play this movie again. So watch any single termite here, and you'll see how it's going about its work. Takes these pellets, and then it is continually depositing it. And it's taking, obviously, the mud from somewhere else and depositing it somewhere. So we started asking very simple questions about it. We decided, let's go back to the very basic question and ask, what is the function of the mound? Is there even a function of the mound? How do they know where to build? How do they manipulate the building material? And this got me interested in soil mechanics, which I never thought would happen. And then what sensory cues guide individual termites in these building tasks? But the null hypothesis has to be that maybe these mounds have no function, right? So we decided to test this hypothesis. We asked, and the test is very simple. What we say is if the mound has any function at all, then making an injury to the mound will cause the termites to repair that injury, correct? If the termites care about the mound, if the mound serves any function, then the termite should repair this breach. So for instance, if you make a hole in the mound, and if not, then they will just not bother. Okay. Now you can imagine, having seen David Attenborough's film, why a hole might be a big problem. A hole is a big problem because it can allow ants to enter. It can be a big problem because it can allow water to enter. So, you know, there are reasons to think that termites may not like a breach. So Sri Krishna, who's also sitting in the back, started this experiment as he was a trainee student. He was a fresh physicist then, and he started this as a student that had just joined the lab. And what he did was he made a hole that was about 2 centimeters in diameter, and the idea was to simply watch the hole after we had made the hole. So here's the hole, and I'll just show you this video. And watch this, and there's a plot that shows just how much of it is built. When it reaches 100%, it means it's completely covered. So initially, there is a slow deposition process, and now the hole starts to fill up very rapidly, okay? And at some point, it's completely filled, and it tapers off. So we thought this was very nice, because we could now interact with the termites. You know, we could make them do something. And when you can make them do something, then you can ask questions to them. So the first thing we did is we said, well, if this works once, it has to work many times. Otherwise, there is no experiment. So we did this many times at different times of the day. And we found, by and large, this was always the case. You had, you started with a hole, and you ended with a filled hole. And there was always this shape of the curve, which we call a sigmoidal curve, with which this hole was filled. Now, one of the things about a sigmoidal curve, and I'll go into a little bit of mathematics here, is that it involves an exponential rise or exponential recruitment of termites. And what that means is that one termite brings more termites, and more termites bring even more termites at a rate that amplifies geometrically, okay? So you have an exponential rise, and then you have an exponential decay there. And what that suggests then is that there must be some sort of a de-recruitment process. And so these became our next hypothesis. So you ask a question, you get an answer, but the answer gives you more questions. So we made a few assumptions. We said maybe each termite can work at only a constant rate, okay? And if that is the case, then the rate at which the hole is filled suggests something about the number of termites that are actually working. And if that is the case, then the rate at which the hole is getting filled suggests that the number of termites are being recruited at an exponential rate and then de-recruited at an exponential rate. How could this recruitment work? It could work through chemicals. Maybe a termite goes, finds a hole, says, oh, there's a problem, sends out a signal, a chemical spray of some kind, and says, well, you know, anyone who smells it, come here. And then all the termites come there, and they start working. And then when they come there, they see a hole, and they say, oh, there's a hole. And they send out signal. And this amplifies the recruitment process, which would then lead to this kind of an exponential recruitment. The other possibility is that they make a sound, okay? And termites can actually vibrate their heads fast enough that you can hear it. And so it may be that they make a sound. We don't know. We really don't know the answer to that. Yes?
You said they're blind, so you know how they sense the hole?
Excellent question. I'll come to that in a bit. Then about the de-recruitment. So these are just ideas, hypotheses, right? It may be mechanically mediated. Maybe as the hole becomes smaller, the number of termites start to bump into each other. It gets crowded. This turns them off in a neural way. And then it sends them, it sort of causes them to then go away. And then that could cause an exponential de-recruitment. So, the rate of building a good proxy for the number of termites? This was an assumption that went in, and you know, I'm loath to make a model without testing the assumptions first. We need to make sure that the assumptions are solid. So if it is the case that a termite can actually work fast or slow, then all of this model is going to be useless. So we decided to test that. Except we had a problem, which is that you know, there's no easy way to count termites when they are on the other side of the hole. So we had to come up with a way that allowed us to actually see the termites. And Amritansh, who's sitting in the back there, came up with a very nice way. What he did was he stuck a funnel down the hole. And when you stick a funnel down the hole, the termites come out and they start to build on the funnel. Okay, and so the funnel begins to get built over, but you can actually place a camera on top, any camera, even your cell phone camera is good enough, and you can, and this is a regular plastic funnel, and you can see the termites. And then you can take pictures, and then you can count the termites. You can do it in a sophisticated way, or you can do it in a simple way. It doesn't matter. So you know then the rate of building, you can quantify that. You know the number of termites, and you can ask, is the rate of building and the number of termites proportional to each other? And the answer was yes. In fact, they're remarkably proportional to each other, as this is just one example, and these are many. But the R-square values of close to 1 suggests that this is a very, very strong relationship between the number of termites and the rate at which work is done. So is the rate of building a good proxy for the number of termites? Yes. Now we can use these assumptions to actually build a mathematical model. And I'm not going to go through the model in great detail, just to suggest that you know you can build it with differential equations. So you have differential equations that are rates at which things are happening. For instance, here's the rate at which the number is changing, the rate at which the size of the hole is changing. And you can eventually get a differential equation which you can solve and ask, is the solution a curve that looks just like the sigmoidal curve? And in this case, all I can tell you is, yes, it does. Now we come to the question that was asked earlier, which is, you know, you saw these sigmoidal curves, but some of them were more steep and some of them were more shallow. And I told you that we're doing this at different times of the day. So we began to ask, is there a connection between the amount of light and the rate at which the termites work? Sure, they're all sigmoids, but why are some shallow and why are some steep? So we did an experiment in which we made a hole and looked at how it is getting filled through the day, okay? So 8 is 8 o'clock, 22 is 10 o'clock, and this is just time through the day. And if you notice, you know, during the daylight hours, the termites build extremely fast, okay? But, so they're very steep, right? But as we go towards the evening hours, this begins to get shallow. So we felt that maybe light has something to do with it. And the way this experiment was done, another way in which this experiment was done was using a simple assay called the parallel plate assay, in which we put two plates together, and instead of a funnel going down that hole, you have these two plates sitting right on top, and the termites come and start building in the plate, right, as you can see right here. So light seemed to be an issue, although I told you that termites don't have eyes. So we thought, let's check this. So we conducted an experiment in which we took these two things they called Falcon tubes. They're found in all labs, biology labs for sure, and they're transparent. So what we did was we put two of these tubes into the holes. One was transparent, one was covered with black paper. Okay, and we asked, how do they build inside this? Now, the transparent tube was packed with material. The opaque tube was not. Okay, it was packed only on the outside, but not on the inside. And this was extremely interesting. And so what we could then do was take out all the mud and weigh it, and you can see that there's a very clear difference between light and dark. So what this suggests is that light seems to play a role, because there's really no difference between this and this. This was a mound in the shade. The temperatures weren't very different. The only thing different was the fact that one had light and the other didn't. And what that suggests, which was a shock, was that termites seem to be responding to light. They don't have eyes, but they seem to respond to light. So we had to double check this. We had to do another experiment. Yes, please. Entire funnel? We don't know. The short answer to that question is we don't know. But here's something interesting about termites. Termites appear to like surfaces. I'm really anthropomorphizing this, but they walk on surfaces that they build themselves. So if there is a foreign surface of any kind, they will cover it up with mud. This is a real problem for us because, you know, when we're trying to see what's going on inside the mound, we put a camera in, like an endoscopic camera, and the first thing they do is come and covering us. And that's a form of extreme censorship. But, you know, this is what they do. Why they do it, we don't know. Yes.
Can you use the mic, please?
As a follow-up to this question. So at, you have a funnel, right? It keeps opening up. At what point do they stop filling it up? Stop building?
Well, they can stop at various points. Sometimes they cover the whole thing. Sometimes they cover it only partially. It's not clear what dictates when they stop or why they stop. But, you know, it's variable, is all I can say. Again, we don't know exactly what the reasons are for why they build, how much they build, and when they stop, or why they cover it up or versus leave it hollow, right? One possibility is that the initial termites that come in make an assessment of just what the problem is. And they say, oh, there's a lot of light. And if there's a lot of light, then what we need is a certain kind of solution. And maybe they send out chemical signals that say, this is the solution we need, which is just a lot of you come and just build. Whereas if it comes and sees, oh, this is a foreign surface, it doesn't seem right, we need to cover this up, but light is not an issue. Then maybe a different kind of signal goes out. I mean, this is essentially what it comes down to, right? But whether or not that hypothesis is true or not, we need to test. So this was a modification of the parallel plate assay. So we wanted to recheck if they are indeed responding to light. And so what we did was we put a little divider, an opaque divider, between the two parallel plates, okay? And we exposed this side to light and this side to dark. And then later we would come out and take this plate out and ask which side is more built upon. And as you can see, consistently, the lighter side is more built upon and the darker side is less than the lighter side. And these are many repeats of the same experiment. The black is where the light, which is on the lighter side, red is on the darker side, and you can see the black bar is always greater than the red bar. So the some conclusion of this is that although termites don't have eyes, they are able to sense light. We don't know how they are able to sense light, but it shouldn't be unusual for them to have sensors underneath their cuticle. Yes?
Instead of sensing light, could it also be the temperature? Because I noticed that you didn't measure the temperature when you put the two falcon tubes there.
Correct. Yes, it could be the temperature, but it is very unlikely because you can repeat this experiment in a shaded area where the temperature difference between these two sites is really negligible, and you'll still get the same result, right? So again, in the last assay that I showed you, there is not much of a temperature difference between the two sides. The material is conducting. So, you know, possible, yes, but more likely that it's light than temperature. Okay, so this is one aspect. We know that light is important. What are the other cues that might be important? One that comes to mind, because you see this real increase in activity, I'm sure all of you have noticed that, maybe you haven't, but we tend to look at mounds very closely. So we constantly look at this. Whenever there are rains, mounds, there is a lot of activity in the mounds. So next time you see rains, you keep an eye on a mound and see if you see greater activity there, okay? And what you will see is fresh mud right around the mound, right after the rains, okay? And so it appears that maybe moisture might be important. Moisture levels might be important. And what's interesting is that this is not a new observation. This is something that goes back. A student, Yadugiri, who actually knows a lot about the scriptures, brought to our attention these two quotes from two texts, one from the 10th century CE and one from the 13th century CE. And in both these cases, what the author says is that if there is an anthill is what they call a termite mound. It's not an anthill, it's a termite mound. And that's the word for it, Valmiko. If you see an anthill near such and such a tree, and if you go so much distance away, two purushas, that's the length of a person's body, then you will find good water there. And people used to worry a lot about where to find water, and you know, this was a sort of a hint or a clue. And in the other one, again, you have a similar quote which says, you know, if you have these two trees that are surrounded by termite mounds, then you should find an aquifer towards the west at a distance of 4 purushas and 6 hastas, hastas being the elbow to the tip of the middle finger. So this kind of connection of the existence of mounds with underlying aquifers or water sources has been observed in the past. I don't know if it's observed so much as inferred in the past. And so we thought that it's important to conduct some experiments that relate to moisture levels. Here's an example of what I was just talking about. So immediately after rains, you can see that this was the old mound, and that's the new mound. This is fresh mud that has been put right on together with the old mound. So we wanted to ask if this is the case. And Amritansh took on this task. It was a fairly heroic experiment in which he had 5 parallel plate assays, okay, in which what he did was he changed them. So what he took was he took the soil, he dried it completely, and then he put the soil in, and then he put known amounts of water in there. So this was about 13%, this was about 27%, 40, 53, and 67. And then in each of them, he put a set number of termites, about 30 termites in there, and he asked, do you see a change in the building rate, depending on the moisture level of the soil? Do termites like a certain amount of moisture level to be able to build? And so you wait for 45 minutes, and you look at the amount of building that happens, and sure enough, you see a difference. Yeah?
So there is an assumption that termite is spontaneously built, whatever, is there any purpose to
that? Well, termites build, that's what they do, you know? Yeah, it's, the purpose is, of course, you know, the maintenance of the mound, the building of the mound, but, you know, they if they think there is a problem, then they build. This is a really interesting question from the point of view of swarm intelligence. If you're thinking of architecture, and I was going to come to this point towards the end, architecture is something that is centrally guided, where you have a blueprint, and then you give the blueprint to each termite, and you say, okay, this is now how you have to build. Well, this is not how it works here. The way it works here is that, you know, there's a large number of us. Somebody sees a hole in the wall there and sends a signal, or, you know, everybody sees a hole, and if you see a hole, you go there and you work. I mean, that's just seems to be more like what they do. And so they are just internally programmed to be able to do these sorts of things. But it's something that's a much deeper question, and you know, something that's been explored very much in robotics, in swarm robotics and so on. How do you set up these kinds of systems so that they work intelligently together, but not maybe individually? They're just doing something simple, but that there's an emergence of an intelligence. Yes, Smita.
You want to use the mic?
A little unrelated question, but then how does it grow? I've always wondered, does it basically grow from within? Because every day you see, like, it's growing.
Yeah.
Or they deposit it from the top. That part has never been clear to me.
So, you know, the way it works is, firstly, it's sorted. It doesn't all happen continuously. It happens in spurts. Okay? And what happens is you'll have, you know, nothing today, and suddenly there are rains, and then you see some little bit up there. And then it stays like that for a while. And then again there's a bout of rains or something like that, or some hole that happened, and again there is building. And it all boils down, as any construction activity boils down, to excavating from somewhere and putting materials somewhere. And so when they're often building on structures that are already existing, but sometimes they're modifying the structures so substantially as to not, you know, they're like the ship of Theseus. Everything has changed. It's the termites are the same. And they keep sort of, it's the opposite of ship of Theseus, I guess. But, you know, the termites keep building on top of existing structures, but they keep modifying it constantly. Yes.
In this experiment, in different levels of moisture, the rate of building was different.
Yeah.
But then how did they get this mud from?
It's a great question. So there is no new mud here. right? So what it is doing is just taking mud that already exists, and you can see it's all level here, taking from here and putting there. So if there's a height here, there's a well here, you know? So it's just sort of reapportioning the material from here and putting it there, right? Nice question. So clearly moisture matters, okay? And they need some optimal level of moisture at which they can work, optimally. So the question then is, if moisture is so important, is there a way that termites can actually modulate moisture? We know that the moisture content of freshly built soil is almost always 18% or so, roughly around that this thing, regardless of what the environmental conditions are. So they seem to like this. We know that worker termites ingest soil in their mouth, they regurgitate the soil, they mix it with some fluid, and they're putting. So, you know, there is a constant loss of moisture. And so that has to be replenished. We also know that there is, we see termites with swollen bellies. We put an endoscopic camera down and we actually saw these termites with swollen bellies. And we began to wonder, what are they doing? And we figured they must be transporting moisture. So we decided to test that with a simple assay in which we used a chemical called fluorescein. It glows when you put UV light on it. And we have a petri plate, two blocks of mud. One is a wet patch, and we mix the water with fluorescein, and one is just a dry soil patch. We illuminate it, and we film it. It's no big deal. But it looks quite nice. So here is a movie. This is speeded up a little bit. So everything that is glowing is termites carrying water. And you can see how they're just sitting there, drinking the water, and then moving to the other patch, where a lot of the building is happening. These are very recent experiments. We haven't really done much with it. I have no conclusions coming from these experiments, except to say that this seems like a very promising method with which to look at how moisture is being moved around. Yeah. They're the same termites. Same termites. They're the same termites. Yeah.
But the termites which are on the right side, they don't seem to transfer to the left side. Only the ones which are on the left side are going to the right side. And
well, that may be because of the moisture gradient, but they are the same. They are from the same colony. In fact, there are instances, again, this is anecdotal, yes.
Do they seem to know the presence of everybody around the mound?
Can they distinguish between different termites
yes,
coming
they
from
can.
Different
mounds? In fact, if you put termites from other colonies in there, there would be a fight. Other species, there would be a fight, and they might kill each other. In fact, that happens a lot. So you can.
That means they know everybody.
So they know their own, and they know self from non-self. Here's an example where there's two termites sharing an intimate moment, right there. And you can see how there might be some transfer of moisture from one to another. So there seem to be things going on. Yes.
Excuse me. I want to ask a question, maybe not this particular slide. The size of the mound which you see and the colony which is inside, is this anything to do with the number of workers and the soldiers who get inside and this height of the mound? Because in nowadays life, we see if it's more areas where there's more people, that you have apartments which are tall, and if there is less people, then apartments which is short.
So if there's a bigger mound, does it mean there are more termites in
there? Yeah, that's what I mean.
Good question. I don't know the answer to that. partly because I don't know how to go about estimating the number of termites in there. I mean, one possible way to do this would be to measure the amount of carbon dioxide coming out of it, right? because each termite is building up. But as I mentioned earlier, there's also that fungus, and that's accounting for most of the CO2. Okay. So it's not really clear. My guess is, yes, it must be like that. But I can't really back it up with evidence.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
In this experiment, one of the patches is a dry...
In this experiment, one of the patches is a dry patch and one is a wet patch.
Yeah.
So are the termites taking water from one patch and putting it in the other?
That's what we think is going on. But these are new experiments, so we still haven't got the full evidence of that. Okay, should I continue? All right, so these are, like I said, very new experiments, so the observations are preliminary, but we think that there's active transport of water from wet patches of soil. There's water transport, maybe a cooperative exercise. How many? How are we doing on time? Huh? Oh, okay, give me 5. All right. Workers lose water from their body while building in dry soil, and termites seem to modulate moisture levels. In the last part of the talk, I want to talk a little bit about the traffic rules inside termites, okay? So I crave your indulgence. This is fun. Yeah. Yes.
How they work in that lab condition? When they are in the field, it's okay.
Yeah.
But when you carry those termites to the laboratory, then how do they work? Is they fail to identify the natural and the lab condition?
Well, apparently, because they seem to work in the lab, you know. Whether they work exactly the same way as they might be working in the mound, I cannot say. But they seem to be doing similar things. So it then, just seems like we are carrying little autonomous programs that are, you know, programmed to do something.
Then they are failing to identify the natural and the laboratory condition.
Maybe, but for them, there is no such thing as a laboratory condition. Everything is natural. And if they see anything different, it just means the natural conditions have been perturbed in a certain way and they need to react.
Okay.
Right? So.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, so let's, oh, sorry, okay.
Before you go ahead, you talked about like soil structure and soil mechanics in that thing. So, When termites consume the mud and then they re-emit, my guess is the soil structure for sure, even soil texture changes.
Yes.
And it completely changes.
Yes, absolutely. This is such a fascinating question because, you know, you see the same termites build in soil that is completely different. You know, you have soil here that is very clayey. And frankly, my son, who's here, he knows more about the soils than I do. So I've been asking him questions about it. But it's more clay, whereas there are other soils that are more sandy, and there are different materials in it. And clearly, this matters a lot. You know, how much soil expands or clay expands with moisture and so on is very different. I'm just learning about it. I never knew anything about this. But now it seems like I have no choice but to learn about this.
I think maybe questions which are explicitly related to what's on the talk, maybe we can have it, and the general questions, we can keep it. There's a lot of time for discussion after the talk. So very general questions, we can keep it at the end, if that's fine with all of you. I think that will make the flow of the talk a bit easier.
We'll just quickly go through this, and then we can. Okay, so here's another experiment, and watch what happens. Okay, so we put a bunch of termites inside a round plastic tube, cylinder. And you go from chaos to order. Okay? And we got very interested in this observation when it was first made. We thought, this is something we can really play around with. For a number of reasons, including the fact that, you know, to me, this looked a lot like a fluid, and I have in my dim and distant past, being a fluid mechanist. So we needed to quantify that, and here's the way we do it. So we take images, and then we track single termites. That's the red spot, is a single termite. And we then ask, how do you go from disorder to order? And you can track you know, maybe 10 or 15 points like this, and they all allow you to then figure out, you know, how they go from disorder to order. And this is work being done by Sri Krishna in the lab. He's also sitting there. So one hypothesis was that this behavior is not density dependent. It is not collective behavior, but it happens in any termite. You put a single termite in, it should also go around. And why do we think so? Because cockroaches do the same thing. So if you take a cockroach, all of you are aware of this, I'm sure, they quickly run to the side of a wall and then they go along the wall. And that's because the wall gives them a barrier against which the antenna can slide. And then the antenna is an extraordinarily sensitive mechanosensor. So it knows, oh, you know, this is how far the wall is from me. And so it goes. And then you can build models and so on. And termites are cockroaches, so maybe termites do the same. So do single termites mill? Milling is this going round and round. And this is the base of their antennae. So here's the termite. Goes to the end. And doesn't really seem to do much of this kind of milling. Right? So maybe it's an outcome of many individual level responses or a collective response of some kind. Also, we would like to know, you know, if it was many individual types, then there's always the possibility of a traffic jam, because some termite might want to go in the other direction, as we all know from Bangalore traffic. So is it density dependent? So here's an experiment that shows you whether or not it is density dependent. So here's termites just doing whatever, and then what we'll do is add more termites to it. Are you convinced that it's density dependent? And here's a plot to show you the time for the onset of milling rapidly decreases as the number density increases. And if you actually calculate the angular velocity of the termites, the rate at which they are moving around, then that increases very rapidly as the number density increases. So the transport is much more efficient. Sorry? Ah, you mean, are they always going clockwise or anti-clockwise? I won't even go there. I don't know, maybe northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere, who knows? Right, so.
In the previous experiment, you suggested that when density increases, there's a less traffic jam?
Well, there's less traffic jam, yes. It seems to be moving more like a fluid. But there also seems to be more, if I should anthropomorphize, sense of purpose.
Is it also related to a sense of insecurity, just trying to escape the confinement?
I don't know. That's between the termites and their shrink. not sure at all. I mean, maybe they feel the threat, you know, when there's a large number of, I don't see why they should, though. Because within colonies, they're moving in very confined spaces. And they do, in fact, need to be able to move fast so as not to clog the environment. So let's try another experiment, OK? Now, in this case, you have these termites, and they're not kind of milling. And we take the thing around, and there they just go in all directions. But if the termites are milling, and you do the same thing, watch what happens. So here are termites that are milling. And they continue to mill for quite a while. OK, now this gets more interesting. If indeed chemicals are guiding this, then you should be able to disrupt it. So here are termites that are milling. And we are going to just deprive them of the chemicals. So there's a plastic surface on top, and we'll take it off. So clearly, there is a chemical trail. And what's interesting is that this chemical trail actually is good enough to work across species. So if you now, what happened? If you now, oh, sorry, this was fine. So this is one species of termites. These are Odontotermes redemani. And we take this out, we empty it, and now we put another species of termite in the same place. Oh, interesting. There we go. Another species of termites, and there they establish milling. Do you see it? Okay, so let's conclude. It's clear that they are using a combination of mechanosensory feedback and chemosensory feedback to go on trails. These cues establish the trails which the termites will follow. The milling behavior is density dependent. More the merrier. That means there'll be this thing. This reduces the time of transport and traffic jams. And chemical cues are not species specific. They're generic cues that seem to somehow break the symmetry for them. So what we've learned is that the integrity of mound is important. We don't know what the mound function is. We still need to investigate that. We know that they're sensing light through some non-ocular means. We don't know where this sense is located. We need to find that. We know that there's active recruitment, de-recruitment. We don't know what the signals involved are. We need to find those. Soil moisture is important for mound structure and building activity, and we need to know how they modulate soil. So let me leave you with one thought. I mean, I started off with a very simple question, and I've ended up with many questions. And this is partly what science is all about. This was recognized long back by this great man, Socrates. So if you were to read The Trial and Death of Socrates, he talks about, there's a story there, which you know I find very inspirational, which is that a student of his goes to the Oracle of Delphi, who's supposed to know all, and asks the Oracle of Delphi, well, is Socrates the wisest man on the planet? And the Oracle of Delphi senses what answer he needs to give and says, yes, Socrates is the wisest man. And so the student goes back to Socrates and says that I have it from the Oracle of Delphi that you are the wisest man on the planet, so here we are. And Socrates is absolutely aghast when he hears that. He says, how can that possibly be? I know nothing. And so he makes it his life's mission to go and find people smarter than him. Okay, and he starts to talk to them about things that they are supposed to be experts in, very quickly realizes that actually they don't know as much as they think they know. And in fact, this series of questions and dialogues is what makes up all of Plato's books. I mean, in sometimes Socrates is used as a character, but this inquiry and dialogue and dialectic process is what really makes science. And what you realize when you go through this is that wisdom is all about not knowing. You know, that's the interesting thing about it, is you start with something that is poorly resolved, then you get some fact, and then you can ask many questions because you now have that one fact. And this is what is sort of the way these things are going. So, you know, science is lovely because it is imperfect and because it generates more questions than it probably answers, but the ones you can answer are actually fun. So I want to stop there. These are the brave people who worked on termites. This is Amritansh, Shri Krishna. Both of them are sitting in the back. There were a series of helpers, people who worked with them, and many of these are high school students. And this is really a project that is meant to be done in your backyard, and we can. And it was funded by the Human Frontier Science Program, which was a fairly generous funding. It was a lot of fun. Thank you.
Yeah. Just wanted to ask.
So before we start with the discussion session, just 1 second. So before we start with the discussions, may I request Professor Rajesh Gopakumar to hand a memento to the speaker for this absolutely wonderful lecture. And
thank you. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, and please raise your hands and wait for the mic to come to you. I will hopefully keep track of who raised the hands first and go in that order, but I may miss, so apologies for that at the beginning. So there was a question at the back. I know I have seen all, so keep your hands up, raised, that's fine. And but wait for the mic, please. Where are the mics? Yeah, so can...
He raised first, actually.
I wanted to ask about snakes getting into mounds and...
Yeah. And you saw the snake, yeah.
Yeah, and the picture came up. So at what point do termites abandon their mounds and why do snakes take refuge in those mounds?
That's a fabulous question. We don't fully understand, but termites... may abandon their mounds because maybe the mounds are somehow inhospitable. Now, the queen can't go anywhere. She has to die. And when she's dead, then I think the mound has absolutely no... it has no reason for existence. Now, we don't know if under those circumstances some other queen can come in and adopt the mound. We don't know this. We don't know of many things about this, you know, how these... mounds are maintained or not maintained. But what we do know is that the moment the colony goes away, the mound begins to crumble. And this is something that architects, I was talking to an architect about this, who called this the perfect death certificate and something that we should aspire for. The idea that you build something, but when its function is gone, it doesn't just stay around, it just goes back to being earth. And that's sort of... But at that point, because there is already a nice thing dug out, snakes can find it, you know, and it's temperature controlled and so on, snakes might find it interesting, a hospitable place to be. So then snakes can enter it. Ants can enter it and, you know, kill all the termites, as you've seen. All sorts of things can happen.
Sir, as regards to that slide you shown in that milling, I seems it is in a... laboratories trials, it happens in a circular motion.
Correct.
When it is exposed to the open air, it may be in a linear way. Generally, it goes in a line.
Yeah.
How that differs and how you identify and come to some conclusion, is it necessary always to go? I cannot say it is in a circular. It cannot go in a circular level always.
In a... In which particular experiment was this? In the chemical trail one? Yeah. Correct.
One after one behind another.
Yeah.
When it is exposed to the open.
Yeah.
Then it may or may not go in a circular. It likely it to go in a straight line. Away.
Yeah, it will not go in a circular way. This really has to do with the underground chambers and the passages through which they move. And the passages through which they move are about, you know, if the antenna is spread out like this, it's about that wide. And so they are moving through this, okay? And so they are sort of following a particular route that the passage guides them through inside the termite mound. Outside the termites, these guys don't have a life outside of the mound. So, you know, they really only build and stay inside the mound and move through the chamber. And the chamber guides how they move.
Question over. Yeah. I don't know who it's...
Here,
speaking.
Here, here.
So, okay, yeah.
So in the beginning, when you mentioned about the poles, you said you were really not sure.
Yeah.
So what are your guesses?
Our guesses is that it's a radiator, that what it is doing is increasing the surface area to be able to radiate temperature and reach equilibrium with the ambient as quickly as possible. That's our guess.
Is it also more about stability, much like paper getting more stable?
And that's another likelihood, yes. It could be that these molds, these folds allow them, the structure to be more stable. Although I don't see any reason why just a cone would not be stable.
Another question, when you notice the head, it's seemingly very translucent.
Yes.
Almost
certainly. Then that's exactly the conclusion we've come to. Yeah.
Thank you.
question over there.
How big can a termite, mound can get?
How big are the termite mounds or the termites?
Ma'am, the termite mound.
Termite mound. The termite mounds can be as high as 4 meters. So, you know, they can go fairly high. The highest ones I've seen are about that high.
And also, if you mix two species of termites, will they still do milling the same way?
No, they fight with each other. And one tries to kill the other. Yes.
I have a question. So due to the mound gets destroyed due to environment condition. So when the remount is done, I mean, when they start building a new mound, do they evolve? Do they build better structures?
Yes. Yes, indeed. What they do is, in fact, you know, whereas the mound might look very static from the outside, from the inside, there might be considerable remodeling going on constantly. And what happens is that when you make a hole there, they come and they cover the hole, and it's very much like a wound healing process. The first thing they do is make a scab, okay, just a thin layer of soil. And then there is a more rigorous task of building that happens on a longer term process.
Hello.
So the first job is to make sure that nothing from outside gets in. And then the following process is extremely rigorous, which might involve a complete remodeling of the interiors. So they are just, you know, constantly active.
Sorry, just 1 second. Can I give preference to the young audience?
Yes.
Do the termites with wings always have to be females or males? Or can they be of both?
They are both. They are in fact both. The funny thing about termites with wings is they have eyes. They are the only ones who have eyes. Otherwise, they couldn't fly. The other ones don't have eyes.
After they form a colony, do they lose their eyes?
No, they don't. They continue to have eyes, although I don't think they use them because they're down in the dark where there's no light. Nice question.
Okay, at the back, yes.
Thank you for this excellent talk. Your big question seems to be how local individual behavior can give rise to this very complex global phenomenon.
Correct.
And you're very interested in the learning algorithms of individual workers. The assumption is that under environmental condition A, they do this behavior. Under environmental condition B, they do this behavior.
Correct.
Have you tried to look at the differences in sensitivities among individual workers to see if there are differences? Or in other words, you look at recruitment behavior, there's a positive feedback associated with it.
Yeah.
Are some individuals, have you marked these individuals and repeat these experiments, are some individuals always more likely to be the initial recruiters? That's an
interesting question. We don't have resolution of that. In large part because it's very hard to work in a mound where the termites are so sworn to secrecy. You know, they will not allow cameras to go in. Marking is a distant dream. We could try doing this in the lab, but I don't know to what extent anybody would believe what we say, you know, given that this is in a very artificial environment. We do see differences in termites, and my student has noticed, for instance, certain termites just don't do anything. They just sit around and, you know, laze about or give moral comfort to the ones who are working hard. We don't know if there are those kind of individual differences, but we do observe those under laboratory conditions.
Sir, I have a question. Like if you cut off the antenna of the termites, how will it affect its ability to follow chemical trails?
Well, because they use the antennae to smell, you know, if you cut off their antennae, they can't smell. They will probably come to a stop. And, you know, a termite stopping in the middle of the traffic is very much like an auto rickshaw stopping in the middle of a traffic. It'll cause a traffic jam. And though, interestingly, since you bring this up, you know, the termite buddies can pick up this termite and keep them aside and even bury it with soil if need be. I mean, we've seen instances of that. I wouldn't say that. I mean, there are, you know, many mechanosensory structures distributed over the body. There are, you know, so they rely on all of them. But antennae are very important.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sorry?
Cockroaches also
Are also? Blind. No, cockroaches are not blind. Cockroaches can actually see. But they operate in conditions of dark, so maybe in practical terms, they don't use their eyes much.
Before we take up more questions from here, so there are people upstairs. There was not enough space here. So let me now ask some of the questions that were sent from people upstairs, and then we'll come back to questions here, until all of you are too hungry to hear any more questions. So do termites have a sense of pressure? And do they sense light through their skin or any other part of their body?
They may have a sense of pressure. In other words, they can actually go from one part to another and maybe sense the difference in air pressures. We can't rule it out. Light, almost certainly they are sensing through some subdermal or, you know, some eye that is, or photosensor that's buried under the skin.
So what is the gender of the worker termites defined by? And how is the gender related to the function of the termites within the colony? And what factors determine which female termite turns into the queen?
Oh, I don't know. I'm not very sure about this. This is where my kind of knowledge begins to end. I'm not very sure about the gender of the termites. You know, I think it's a mix of males and females, but I'm not sure.
Okay, sorry. What, again, can I give preference to the younger people? I will go by the age.
If a termite enters another mound, how will the other termites know that it, like, that it's different?
Oh, that's a very good question. How do termites know if there's a foreigner or an intruder in their mound? And this could be through many ways. It could be through signals, chemical signals. This could be through cuticular hydrocarbons, if that makes any sense. It's chemicals on the cuticle. There are these certain chemicals on the cuticle, which is the covering of the termite. And so they can recognize self from non-self. Okay?
So are there more queens? Are there more than one queens in just one termite mold? Because many termites with wings are sent out. So many of them can mate with each other, and then there can be many queens.
Yeah. This is a good question. Does a termite mound have more than one queens? Can it have more than one queens? I have heard both things, but I'm not sure. As far as I know, there's only one queen, but it may be that there are, you know, if someone finds that, that would be quite an interesting discovery, I would think.
You have established photosensitivity with a great certainty.
Sorry, I couldn't hear
you. You have seen photosensitivity in termites.
Yes.
So are you thinking of, or have you already explored optical filtering to see if there could be any sensitivity with corresponding to the wavelength? Or
wavelength. Do you think so spectral behavior, spectral I don't know. You know, it is a good question. That's sort of, once you know that they see, then you can ask those questions. That's exactly what I meant by, you know, you get more questions. This is one of them, actually. It's just not, you know, we're going after the low-hanging fruit right now.
Yes, hi. How do they differentiate between the workers, which is the Shudras, and the Kshatras, which is the soldiers? How they know who is who and which duty, you know, because Kshatriya or soldier can stay and worker can work, you know, and it's in the same time, one of them can say, oh, you know, my parents are such and such. I don't need to do this job, you know, I want to be soldier, you know, how to know? Since it correlates with the Sanskrit, you know, that you brought, I was just surprised how they also go by this classification.
It's a good question. And in this case, like the Indian Army, you know, they seem to do all kinds of work. So soldiers will work if need be. It is not so clearly segregated between soldiers and workers. But the soldiers have these mandibles, as you saw. And these are really potent weapons. And what they do is they are used, of course, to stab an incoming intruder or something like that. So they're morphologically different, structurally different. And I'm sure they're chemically different. You know, maybe that's the way they know, you know, which one is which.
So they don't make any kind of construction work, they just stay and occupy the space until they're through the crowd.
Well, not so. Do you have any, what kind of work are the soldiers doing? Defense, yes, but do they do construction work?
Not really. I mean, so whenever there's a breach, the first ones to come out and be on the guard are the soldiers. And you can also see them fighting with ants otherwise, because workers are pretty helpless. And it's just basically the difference between the size, the type of the mandibles. So soldiers can't really build because the mandibles are they just keep attacking it. The workers have a different kind of mouth parts, which is easier for them to ingest and actually put the pellets. So soldiers mostly do defense and guard the whole thing. Like, you know, if there is some construction happening, they'll be all around, like, you know, with their antenna up out, just to, yeah.
And how the queen knows which ratio to create?
Just a thought, Dad also discussed this with me, that can we take inspiration from the way termites build their structures? As human beings, can we take inspiration from this into how we build our buildings and structures and other engineering
That's
systems?
Very interesting, you should bring this up. So, you know, in my institute, one of my tasks was to be in charge of the technical services. And one of the lessons we learned from termites we've actually adopted, which is to maintain constantly rather than, you know. So what we've realized is that there's a constant maintenance that's required in the mounds. And in fact, if you work like that, it's much more economical than if you were to allow things to break down and then rebuild them. And this is a direct lesson that I learned here, and we've been trying to implement. So yes, I think there's a lot of inspiration that can come from studying the structures and processes to traffic rules and so on. I think
people have looked at this. They're starting to look
well,
at
this. No, not really. I mean, I'm just being more focused on how the biology works. Yeah. And I think if we describe the biology well enough, then those lessons can be implemented at a later stage, but we need to be sure we are rigorous with you know, the task at hand. Then maybe the lessons will be self-evident.
So one question from the top.
Yeah.
Will termites build if they are given a soil-like material? And if such a material can be made to be translucent, can it be used to study live functioning building of a colony?
Yeah, they will build if it has the right kind of feel to it. But you know, it's still going to be very difficult to see through this material because there are little pellets of it, and there are pellets that are covered and so on. And I'm not sure.
So the question was, if a material which is translucent with which they can work, can it be made?
Yeah, I mean, it could be translucent, but you still may not be able to see through it because you know it has to be small material, the size of its mound.
You told that these soldiers are without, they don't have the eye. So, and you observed that with the different species, they followed the same chemical and all. Like one formed a circle, so you removed the species and the other species also formed the same enzyme.
Yeah.
So without eye and without enzyme change and all, how they will distinguish between one colony to other colony? Suppose one termite came from the other colony, some group. So how they will find it is different from our colony and how they will fight?
I mean, I think the lesson we learned from that is that, you know, a chemical trail is sufficient to get the termites to follow that trail. Now, we could take this a step further and ask, what if you had, instead of any termite chemical, just a you know, a pen of some kind, you know, of some synthetic chemical, would you then be able to get the termites recruited? And the answer apparently is yes. So all that the trail is doing is breaking the symmetry, right? It is not really, maybe the chemical composition is not so important as just for termites to say, oh, I can smell something, and I need to follow this. So it's not, yeah, that seems to be where it is going right now.
Okay, so I think we are just about, well, it's getting late. So one last question, sorry. There have been lots of hands that are still up, but there is coffee outside. So after this last question, maybe we can end the discussion here and then go for coffee and then ask questions to him during coffee.
Or you can email them to me.
Sir, we observed that before mating, they desperately fight for the light. And after mating, the queen is somehow the queen is somehow kept in the mound such that the light is not allowed to enter inside the mound.
Yeah.
So is there a theory which suggests that before mating, the queen desperately needs light, and after the eggs are produced, we have to avoid the light to we want to avoid the light from the queen so that the queen's body is not affected by the light directly, and that is why the mound is kept closed at all times.
That seems to be what they're doing. You know, that's a description more than anything else. So yes, that's what's going on. As to whether or what the meaning is, or you know, I'm not sure. I think it is, you know, there is a time in its life and a certain hormonal composition which you know, predisposes it to flying towards light, and then maybe there is another a completely different composition that causes it to do the other things, or actually avoid light. Now, this is not unusual at all. There are many insects which will burrow actively when they are larvae, but then when they have emerged from the pupae, they will seek light. Right? So those sorts of changes, behavioral changes, are very, very common.
Okay, lots of questions. I know there is still a lot more questions. I'm happy to see that there's a lot of curiosity. So let's actually also have some coffee, and you can ask questions over coffee or email him, as he mentioned. So before that, let's thank Sanjay once more for a wonderful lecture.